Hello, I'm Jorge Gestoso. Welcome to a new show. On today's program, the human rights situation in the United States under the Trump administration. Our guest, Sarah McBride, one of the most visible transgender activists in the U.S. and National Press Secretary of the Human Rights Campaign. Sarah McBride, a warm welcome to the program.
Thank you so much for having me.
Sarah, you're the first transgender woman to speak at a national political convention. We're talking 2016 Democratic National Convention with Hillary Clinton. Tell us about it.
Well, it was an incredible experience. It was, of course, a critical election in 2016. We had made historic progress on many issues around LGBTQ equality here in the United States. Barack Obama was the most LGBTQ supportive president that we had ever had in our history. And between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, we had a choice between a candidate and Hillary Clinton who would continue that legacy of action and that progress under her administration, or Donald Trump, who had promised to appoint anti-equality extremists to the federal bench, endorsed nearly every single anti-equality position you could take. And so it was a really critical election to be participating in, and to have the opportunity to stand on that stage in front of tens of thousands of people in a massive arena, have it streamed on television and cable, to be the first transgender person to have that opportunity on that stage was really powerful. It was empowering, and I think more than anything else, it was a responsibility, because I wanted to reinforce for folks that the fight continues, there's still so many issues that we need addressed, and more than anything else, that at the end of the day, behind this national conversation on transgender rights are real people.
In this year, 2018, came to the market this book.
Yes.
It was released, and it was called Tomorrow Will Be Different, Love, Loss, and the Fight for the Trans Equality, and it was forwarded by Joe Biden. Tell us about Joe Biden.
So I'm from Delaware, a state just about 2 hours north of Washington, D.C., and Joe Biden, before he was Vice President of the United States, was our state senator. And I had the chance to get to know and work for his son, Beau Biden, who unfortunately recently passed away from cancer. And Joe Biden, throughout his career, has been a champion of equality and civil rights. He has been a vocal supporter of the LGBTQ community. And so it was an incredible honor to have him write the foreword for this book, where he talks about not just his relationship with me and his son's relationship with me, but also the broader fight for LGBTQ equality. I wrote this book, which is the story of my own journey as a transgender person, my journey as a transgender advocate, and my relationship with my late spouse, Andy Craig, who was a transgender man who passed away from cancer. I wrote this book because I wanted to demonstrate what I try to demonstrate at the convention, which is that transgender people and LGBTQ people writ large love and laugh, hope and dream, fear and cry, just like everyone else. And in the lessons I've learned as an advocate, in the lessons I've learned as a transgender person, and in the lessons I've learned as the spouse of someone who passed away from cancer, I've recognized that there's what Dr. Martin Luther King called a fierce urgency of now. That every single day matters when it comes to building a world where every person can live their life to the fullest. And I wanted to write this book to reinforce those lessons, to share my own personal story, and to give people the information they need to fight for equality.
How long took you to write it?
It took me about 6 months to write the book. I wrote it in the first 6 months of the Trump administration, January of 2017 through June of 2017. And while I had been planning to write this book before then, and while there was still so much that needed to be done on behalf of the LGBTQ community in the United States, the election and the inauguration of Donald Trump reinforced that there would be some of our biggest battles would be ahead of us, and reinforced that renewed sense of urgency with his election.
Let's go step by step.
Yeah.
Tell me what you are reflecting in your book. You were born in Delaware, not that far from here.
Yeah.
Tell me at what point you decided to come out.
Yes.
Tell me about your parents, your brother, your sisters. Tell me all.
When I was born in 1990 in Wilmington, Delaware, the doctors and my parents thought I was a boy. I was assigned male at birth. But from my earliest memories, I knew deep down who I really was, that I was really a girl. And I knew that there was a part that society expected me to play, and I knew that if I told anyone about that fact, that I could risk discrimination, violence, prejudice, and so I kept it inside. I think it's difficult for people who aren't transgender to understand what it feels like to be stuck in the closet, to have a gender identity that differs from the sex you were assigned at birth. And the closest thing that I can compare it to was a constant feeling of homesickness, an unwavering ache in the pit of my stomach that would only go away when I could be seen and affirmed as myself. And so for me, it wasn't a choice. It wasn't an effort to be happy. It was an effort to alleviate a nearly constant pain and incompleteness in my life. So when I was 21, I came out to my parents on Christmas Day in 2011. And then I eventually came out to my student body at American University here in Washington, D.C., because at the time I was serving as student body president. And as I looked around campus and saw the response to my coming out, as I looked around the United States and the world for that matter, and saw the experiences of most LGBTQ people and most transgender people, it reinforced for me that it shouldn't be a privilege to be able to keep your family after you come out. It shouldn't be a privilege to be able to keep your job or stay in school after you come out, and it certainly shouldn't be a privilege to be safe from violence after you come out. And so I wanted to make sure that I utilized my own privilege to try to make a little bit more space for other people to live their lives more fully and freely.
And then you posted on Facebook
Yes.
your decision, and what happened?
So I published a note on Facebook, and then that note was actually picked up by the student newspaper
and
at American University. And it went viral. And it was really incredible to see the response from the campus community when I did that, because I was truthfully very nervous. It was 2012 at this point, well before what our media has sort of deemed the transgender tipping point here in the United States. And so I wasn't quite sure how my campus would respond, but they responded with nothing but love and support. And what I always said as student body president was that our college campuses should look like the country we want to build in 10 or 15 years. And I think on that night, our campus was trying to send a message to this country and this world, which is that while we may not totally understand what it means to be transgender, this is how you respond, with love, with kindness, with acceptance, and with respect.
What would you say that is the situation of the LGBT community in the U.S. today?
Well, I think it's so important because obviously the Trump-Pence administration cast a long shadow in conversations around LGBTQ equality. And I think it's important to acknowledge that we faced a lot of challenges even before the inauguration of Donald Trump and Mike Pence as president and vice president. Despite the fact that we had marriage equality become nationwide in 2015, LGBTQ people in this country still did not have clear protections from discrimination in the workplace, in housing, in public spaces, in schools.
And when they came to the White House.
And when they came to the White House, they added to those challenges by really putting their focus on trying to roll back the clock on the progress we've made, and in particular trying to target the transgender community for discrimination. Just a few weeks after taking office, the Trump-Pence administration rescinded life-saving guidance issued by the Obama administration promoting the protection of transgender students. They've appointed anti-equality extremists to administration positions in the federal judiciary. They've granted a sweeping license to discriminate to government workers, federal contractors, and even healthcare professionals to deny services to LGBTQ people. And of course, in a series of tweets, the president sought to reinstate a ban on transgender people serving openly in the military. And so over the last year and a half, this administration has truly become the most explicitly anti-LGBTQ administration in modern U.S. history.
What is your reading regarding, for example, discrimination, intolerance, race discrimination? In that case, we're seeing also in terms of immigration.
Yeah.
It has always been there. Is it in the fabric of the U.S., or is something that has been exacerbated by President Trump?
Well, first off, his attacks on LGBTQ people, to your point, are part of an ongoing, broader effort to attack the rights and dignity of Black, Latinx, Asian, Native American people in this country, women, people with disabilities, immigrants and Muslims. So this is part of a broader effort by this administration to target the rights of minorities and marginalized groups in this country. But to your point as well, these are issues that the United States has struggled with throughout our history. And in many ways, the story of the United States is the story of trying to overcome these sins of our past and the sins of our present. Those sins include not just homophobia and transphobia, but racism, misogyny, xenophobia. And so this is a long-standing issue, but I do think that the policies and the rhetoric of the Trump-Pence administration have without question emboldened some of the darkest undercurrents in our society, which is why we saw during and in the aftermath of the last election a rise in hate-based violence and harassment in this country. I don't think it's a coincidence that that coincided with Donald Trump's campaign, where he began by calling immigrants from Mexico rapists and murderers. It began with...
And calling Muslims terrorists.
And trying to ban people from Muslim countries from coming into the United States, from making incredibly sexist and misogynistic comments about women, from admitting to sexual assault. This is a person who campaigned with bluster and bigotry, and he's governing with bluster and bigotry.
But in political terms, what we consider the Trump base voters, they don't have trouble with that discrimination.
Right.
Why?
Well, so he has 80% of approval within the Republican base, but his approval ratings are at a record low for this early in a presidency, with roughly only 40% of Americans approving of his job. But I think you are right that Donald Trump campaigned and governed in a way that is meant to appeal to his firmest supporters and his base. And that is to the detriment of the vast majority of people in this country. It's to the detriment of his own base, for whom he is using dog whistles when it comes to race and gender and immigration to line the pockets of his wealthy donors and his friends in Wall Street and in the business community. He has really, at the end of the day, his only legislative accomplishment is a tax scheme that seeks to undermine health care for working people to line the pockets of the uber wealthy in this country. And he's doing that by trying to keep his base in line through throwing them red meat and rhetoric and policies that harm people of color, women, immigrants, Muslims, and LGBTQ people in this country.
You're mentioning in your book the word love, loss. Why loss?
So I come to my work as an activist, not just as someone who is transgender, but also as someone who's loved someone who's transgender. I met my future husband, Andy, fighting for equality, and we fell in love.
You met him at the White House.
I met him in the White House. I met him in the Obama White House at a reception honoring the LGBTQ community in June of 2012. And we quickly fell in love. He was one of the most compassionate, one of the kindest, one of the most optimistic people I've ever met in my life. It was an honor and a privilege to be able to love him and to know him and to learn from him. About a year into our relationship, he was diagnosed with cancer. And unfortunately, after getting a clean bill of health, he received the news that every single cancer patient fears. His cancer was back, it had spread, and for him it was terminal. Now, as I mentioned, Andy was a transgender man. He had come out in college at a relatively young age, and he was supposed to have 3/4 of his life as his authentic self. But unfortunately, just a month after he received the terminal diagnosis, and just 4 days after we were able to marry on the rooftop of our building, he passed away. And he was unlucky enough, due to cancer, to now only experience less than 1/4 of his life as his authentic self. And in reflecting on that experience, I know so many people are able to experience even less time than that. And for me, it reinforced what I said at the beginning, which is that there's a fierce urgency of now in this fight, that every single day matters, and that when we ask transgender people or LGBTQ people or immigrants or Muslims or people of color living in this country or around the world to sit back and allow for a slow conversation to take place before we treat them with respect, we are asking those people to watch their one life pass by without the dignity and the fairness that every person deserves, and that is too much to ask of anyone.
Tell us about, so far, your experience as an activist.
Well, so I, as I said, when I came out at American University, I saw my own privilege, and I saw just how difficult it was for me to come out, but still how relatively easy it was compared to the experiences of most people. And so I wanted to try to change that, to make sure that the privileges that I had were no longer a privilege, but a right guaranteed to everyone, no matter their identity or background. So I worked in my home state of Delaware to pass protections for transgender people from discrimination in employment, housing, and public spaces. And then eventually I began working nationally with a place called the Center for American Progress, and now at the Human Rights Campaign, the nation's largest LGBTQ civil rights organization, to try to advance equality at the national and federal level so that a person's zip code or the state they live in doesn't dictate whether they're treated with respect and fairness.
Tell me what you think about diversion, tolerance. What do you think about the right to love whoever you want to, which is the essence? Tell me.
I think that's such an important question, because it's so easy for us to think that Donald Trump and Mike Pence and those in the White House are reflective of our culture and our country writ large, that America as a whole is moving backward. But I think what we have seen since the last election is that no presidency and no election will halt the momentum of this movement or diminish our ability to open hearts and change minds. And I think that's one of the things we've seen over the last few years, not just on LGBTQ issues, but on so many issues, which is that every single time these anti-equality politicians come for us, we end up having a conversation with this country that changes public opinion and in the end sows the seeds of the destruction of the politics of hate that people like Donald Trump and Mike Pence seek to implement. And so I think that Donald Trump and Mike Pence do not represent the vast majority of fair-minded people in this country. Donald Trump and Mike Pence do not represent who we are in our best moments as a country. They represent our original sins, they represent the sins of our past, the sins of our present, but they don't represent our highest ideals or aspirations. And I think that's why in the end, the people this November will vote in a pro-equality majority in Congress to pull the emergency brake on this administration's dangerous policies, and why in the end, I think in 2020, will elect a pro-equality president to the White House.
Did you have the chance to meet Chelsea Manning?
I have not met Chelsea Manning.
But you have heard about her?
Yes, absolutely.
We're talking about a case that took national attention because there was a soldier who revealed secret information and because of that has been incarcerated and tortured. And then while in jail,
right,
decided to come out and change
right.
genders and became now Chelsea Manning, was initially Bradley Manning.
Since come out as transgender. You know, I think the experience of Chelsea Manning reinforces an important point for all of us, which is that a person's dignity and identity, having that identity respected and affirmed, shouldn't be impacted by the actions of mm-hmm. the person. That there is a first principle that regardless of the crimes one commits, every person deserves to have their identity respected, to be safe from violence, to be treated with respect, whether they are in your neighborhood or whether they're incarcerated or in prison. And so I think Chelsea's experience reflects a broader need for our country to recognize that individuals who are incarcerated, and we have a massive problem with mass incarceration in this country, but individuals who are incarcerated, whether they're incarcerated for nonviolent crimes, whether they're incarcerated for breaking federal law by revealing these secrets, regardless of what you think of those crimes, that our Constitution requires us to make sure that every person is treated equally, and that includes those who are in prison.
And it does happen with police in the transgender community.
One of the things that I think is so important for us to remember is that the modern LGBTQ civil rights movement was launched in response to police violence at the Stonewall Inn in the late 1960s in New York. And so our movement was launched as a riot in response to police violence. And we know that LGBTQ people of color face a disproportionate amount of discrimination, of stigma, of violence. And that includes LGBTQ people of color who are interacting with the police, so often facing disrespect, so often having their identities undermined, and in some cases facing police violence, as we've seen for non-LGBTQ people of color as well. And so this is a problem for our community. This past year, we had the deadliest year on record for the transgender community. 2017 was the deadliest year on record for our community, and at least 28 transgender people, mostly trans women of color, particularly black transgender women, were killed. And at least that number, because we think that there may be more whose stories remain misreported or unknown. And one of the common problems we see is that after these murders, too often those who are tasked with protecting our community end up misgendering and disrespecting the lives and the dignity of these transgender victims. And so it's so important for us to make sure that we are passing laws that require equal treatment, to make sure that we are pushing law enforcement and police departments to be trained on inclusive and competent interactions with LGBTQ people, to make sure we're building trust between communities of color, LGBTQ communities of color, and the police by communication and by tangible steps. But it's a problem that our community, particularly folks of color in our community, face.
And when you say communication and LGBT community, do you have communications with other LGBT communities around the world? What's going on with the other LGBT communities other than in the U.S.?
Yeah, so, you know, we know that in a number of places, including in Brazil, which has had an extreme problem of anti-trans violence with hundreds of transgender people killed in recent years, that this isn't a phenomenon that's isolated to the United States. Anti-LGBTQ and anti-trans violence exist in countries around the world. And that crosses culture, it crosses continents. And so this is truly a international issue that we have to address as a world, not just as individual countries. And we have to acknowledge that all of us have universal basic human rights to be safe from violence and to be able to live our lives authentically and fully without fearing discrimination or harassment.
And talking about ages, for example, would you say that older generations are more reluctant to openness and tolerance than younger generations?
Well, I think there's two things. One, there is no question that we have continued to open hearts and change minds among people of every age, and that support for equality continues to grow across demographics, including across age. But there's also no question that younger generations have an exposure to LGBTQ identities and support for LGBTQ identities that is really unrivaled. And that younger people are some of the fiercest fighters for LGBTQ people and equality in this country. And it's through conversations between young people and their parents and grandparents that I think a lot of those hearts have been changed and hearts have been opened and minds have been changed. When President Obama endorsed marriage equality, he cited conversations with his daughters. And so those are the types of things that are happening in living rooms and around dining tables across the country and around the world. And I do think that at the end of the day, younger people are really speaking from a place of history.
Why did you put in the title of your book, Tomorrow Will Be Different? How different will be tomorrow?
You know, I think that's a really important question. And it's a line from my convention speech. Sometimes tomorrow is different in a good way. It's a step forward. It's the passage of a positive law. It's the election of pro-equality candidates. It's the opening of hearts and changing of minds. But sometimes tomorrow can be different in a bad way. It can be the loss of a life, the passage of a discriminatory law, acts of discrimination and violence and rejection. And I wanted to title the book Tomorrow Will Be Different because I believe that tomorrow will be different. And the question is how. And we all have a responsibility to speak out, to fight back against injustice so that we can make more tomorrows better than today.
So you're optimistic?
I am optimistic. Despite all the challenges, I remain as hopeful and optimistic as I've ever been.
Sarah McBride, thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me.